Thank you. This is my favorite place to come to present and to work. And I'm here for 2 days. I'm here to present to you right now, but I'm just happy to talk. Had a really great lunchtime conversation with Ivan about Da Vinci School. So I'm here to learn with you and brainstorm with you. So this is my 43rd year in education, and my passion in education is that what we are held accountable for in schools is not at all connected to the way life works. When your kids that you have in school are done with their school and they enter life, they're never going to be measured by test scores again. Like, that's not what life is about. Life is not about how you do on tests. Life is about two things: the quality of work that you do and the quality of person that you are. And I feel like that's what we've got to focus on in schools. And it's really hard for you and for me and for all of us, because that's not what the pressure is about, but that's what life is about. So my message here is not like projects are a cool thing to do. It's like, this is how life works. Doesn't matter what life choice your students make, the quality of who they are and the quality of what they do will be how they're measured and how they find success in life. So we've got to sort of shift education to focusing on more than just test scores. I am not a employee of High Tech High. So I am lucky enough to have been around High Tech High since before it started, because I was lucky enough to know Larry Rosenstock before he came west. In fact, Larry was running Ringe Technical School of the Arts, CTE school in Cambridge, Massachusetts, when we first met. And his obsession with quality work was so resonant with me that when he came out here, I felt lucky to come sort of help. And I've been here every year since, just to be a colleague with this work. I work for a different organization, a nonprofit called EL Education. We used to be called Expeditionary Learning. And our mission is to change the conversation about what student achievement means. So right now, student achievement means test scores in two subjects. That's all it means. And if you doubt that, picture a headline in your local newspaper that says, "This high school is high achieving." What does that mean? It means their math and their literacy test scores are good. That's the only thing it means. It doesn't mean that the kids are articulate, that they're great writers and readers and understanders. It doesn't mean they're doing good for the world. It doesn't mean they're working for justice and equity. It doesn't mean they're creating beautiful music. It doesn't mean they're changing the world. It means their test scores in math and literacy are good. And so I am working my entire life around this mission to, can we change the conversation about what student achievement means to a real broad vision that reflects the way they'll be judged in the world? So in EL, we would say student achievement has three dimensions. One of them is mastery of academic skills and content. But that's not test scores. That's like becoming great readers, writers, scientists, historians also. But a whole nother category is character, because the quality of who you are as a human being is the most important thing. So if you have kids, or if you have grandkids or nieces and nephews, the thing you care about most in the world is that they are a good human being, is that they're kind to you and to your family, that they're honest, that they know how to manage their lives, that their personal attributes of character are the most important thing. And yet, it's not what we usually talk about at schools. And I know that I go a lot of places and they say, schools are not about character. That's not the business of schools, right? That's a business of family or church. And I say, this is not something you have a choice about. Like, your school is imbuing character all day long in your kids, whether you want to or not. You're either doing it terribly or you're doing it meaningfully and well. Like, this is not a choice for you to build good people, because the way you treat kids and you let them and compel them to treat each other either makes them more compassionate and kind, more courageous, more resilient, or less so. You build their identities as much as anyone, and you actually spend way more time with them than they do at their church or even with their family. Like, you have the biggest chunk of their time in the week. You have tremendous power, so we better be talking about the kind of human beings we're creating if we want to make this world a better place, if we want to live in an equitable democracy. And then lastly, I, like Larry and so many people here at High Tech High, are obsessed with high quality work, because craftsmanship is what matters in the world. Once you get out of schools. So why are we not obsessed with craftsmanship? So that's my mission and vision in this work. I will tell you that I wanted to give a quick ad for a book I just read that was written by someone here, Sarah Fine, and Jal Mehta from Harvard, a colleague of mine at Harvard, and it's about the American high school, and they went all over the country trying to find good high schools, and they couldn't find any, except a few. One of them was High Tech High. They changed the name to Dewey High School. It was, and then they changed the name of Larry Rosenstock and everyone to pseudonyms that you can tell in a second who they are. But the main point of their book was not an ad for High Tech High or a particular high school. What they mostly found in 7 years of going to high schools was that the most important things that happened in high school happened after the bell at the end of the day. Because all day long, kids were just in classes where they were passively supposed to get content to get ready for tests. And they were not deeply engaged, and they were not really pushed, and they didn't have leadership, and they weren't creating things of value or beauty. But as soon as the day ended, then they went to drama to get ready for the play, or they went to Model UN, or they went to mock trial, or they went to debate club, or they went to sports, or they went to the orchestra, and then they were treated respectfully as kids that were not going to be graded. They were going to create something of value for the world. They were going to get good at something. And there was mentorship going on. It was like real world stuff. And these same kids that were so passive and disengaged during the day became animated and alive after school. And the question they pose in this new book, which I really recommend, is why is the whole school day not like that? Like, why do we wait until the school day ends for kids to go to those opportunities? And when it's structured that way, kids of financial privilege can stay after school for those things, and kids who have to go to an after-school job or take care of their younger siblings cannot. It's just wrong. So can we restructure school so that the cool things are happening during the day when kids are being charged to create things of value for the real world during the regular school day? So I'm going to just quickly say, the organization I work for, EL Education, we're 25 years old, we're a nonprofit, and with this mission to change things, everything we create is open source, like High Tech High does the same. So if there's anything I share today that's of use to you, go to our website and just take it. Like, everything is free, everything is open source. That's our main website, and we have about 300 videos we've created. Everyone is online for free. You can use them, watch them in any way you wish. I'm going to show just a couple videos today. We created right now the country's highest rated K-8 literacy curriculum, and it's totally free. So Pearson hates us. Scholastic hates us. We have spent about $1 million on lawsuits since it came out to not be crushed by the big for-profit publishers because we're giving our whole curriculum away for free. But if that's of use to you, you can use it in any way you want. You can download it, and then you can change it however you want because it's just open property to use. We've got a bunch of books. I can't give those away for free because our publisher won't allow us to, but I hope that they could be useful to you. And then lastly, many of you have seen this, but we have the Models of Excellence website. And it's 43 years of collecting great work from all of you, schools like yours, and hosting them online. I hope that you'll submit work to this website. And it's a place where we try to document the whole story of work. So thank you. So I'm going to quickly say, Randy's right. Just to put this in context, before I was working on books, before I worked for EL, I spent a long time teaching regular public school in a small town in Western Massachusetts. Larry's actually was just there last month. This is a town where we only have a few buildings. Like, that's the whole town. So this is what it looks like. There's the church in the center of town. There's Mary Dillman's house, which is also the post office. So to get your mail, you got to go into Mary Dillman's house. And I taught Mary Dillman, and I taught Mary Dillman's kids, and I taught Mary Dillman's grandkids. We have the town hall, which was a two-room schoolhouse until the 70s when I got there. And then the only business in town, which is the Shute Spray Athletic Club. There are no weights or elliptical machines or treadmills in this. This is a bar in the middle of the woods. And it's surrounded by pickup trucks half the year and snowmobiles the other half of the year. And if you wonder why it's called the Athletic Club, any time of day you go in there, sports are going to be on TV. And the bartender will be one of my former students. So this is why I care about character and quality work. So everyone in my town is my former student. So my nurse is my former student. Our whole volunteer fire department are my former students. My plowman is my former student. My plumber is my former student. The policeman in our town is my former student. Like, I don't care what grade they got on their test score in third grade. I care that they have integrity and compassion and that they do high quality work. So, I mean, to give a real example, I was building a structure for my grandkids at my daughter's house one Saturday morning. I was on the roof of what the castle I was building for them. It's like a medieval castle, you know. And my wife had a serious accident in my home. The entire response team were my former students. Everyone who showed up at my house were my former students. So if you think, if someone you love was in an emergency and everyone that showed up to help her or him was your former student, what would you want them to be like? Like, what would matter to you? And that's where I feel like I knew my former students would have high standards for who they were as people, for the quality of work that they did. Like, that's what matters. And even though you might not live in a weirdly small town like I do, where everyone knows you, and where even the bartender is your former student, and there's no privacy, like, you may not live in that, but if there's an emergency in your home, everyone who shows up is somebody's former student, right? Like, if we think of the world in those ways, who do we want our kids to be? We want them to have high standards for the work that they do. So my message to you today is about projects, but it's about quality work too. So I think we underestimate kids' ability to do quality work. I will show, Randy mentioned a few of the projects, and I'll just go, we'll go through those quickly, Randy. Sure. We don't have a government in my town. Like, everyone in the town comes into a room like this and fights at town meeting about everything. And it's pure democracy, right? So there's no mayor, there's no, and so we don't have all those departments in town. We don't know, like, all the health and safety stuff. So we just took the kids and made them basically the employees of the town in a way. My students did the radon studies for every home in town. And the radon report they created in 94 is still the one that the town uses to figure out where we have radon problems when we build homes and who needs radon reduction for their ones. We did water studies of everyone's well in town. And we took samples of all the streams in town. We tested all those at in a college laboratory, and everyone got their reports, including me, for my home. I had problems in my home, actually. And then we, as Randy said, we studied all the amphibians in town for the statewide amphibian census. So kids went through all the lakes and streams in town and did all the collection that another town's experts did, and created the biggest database of amphibians of anyone in the state. And they also created the world's first salamander tunnels to protect these spotted salamanders. Here they are coming out of the tunnel. And this salamander tunnel is just a mile from my house. So I think kids can do great things like this. How do we get you as ambassadors? Because you guys are not here just to get your students better. You are the torchbearers. You're the ambassadors in your schools, in your districts for this kind of work. How do we get your colleagues? How do we get your school and your district to embrace this stuff more fully? And so my suggestion is, can we focus on quality work? if you say to teachers, you need to do projects now, a lot of teachers would be like, it's too much, I can't deal with it, I can't. But if every single teacher that you work with gets work from her students, and she's not satisfied with the quality of that work, every teacher wishes her students' work was better. Can we focus on the quality of what teachers are getting from their students? Can we think about what a good lab report is, what a good scientific experiment is, what a good essay is, what a good report is? Like, can we focus on quality together? And so one of the things that we compel the 150 schools that we work with in EL to do is to regularly have quality work protocols that they run in their schools. So all the teachers in the school, every single teacher has to take work from her classroom or his classroom and bring it and share it together and use a rubric to discuss where they're seeing quality multiple times per year. And that's scary when you're a teacher. It's scary to bring your kids' work and have it out there. These meetings are not evaluative. They're not a part of a teacher's evaluation. Nobody gets in trouble. The school principal isn't walking around checking to see who did a good job. It's to calibrate where are we seeing quality in our student work, where are we not, and how can we lift it. So in your folder, I left sort of the whole packet of what we do when we do those quality protocols. So behind your agenda, there is a multiple page document that is, let's see what color it is. It's not the pink one. It's not the green one. Gold. It's the gold one. So it's the goldenrod one. It's the protocol that our schools use. I'm not giving it to you so you should follow it. I'm giving it to you to hope that you think about, we should do something like this. We should build a protocol. You can borrow any parts of this you want, but this is the full protocol of how we have teachers bring the work from their classrooms and look at it together, not for their accountability, but to talk about how are we doing with the quality of work we're getting. So the quality of daily work as well as the quality of long-term project work. Like, how can we get kids to be more craftsmen and craftswomen in what they do? Near the back of that, there's a sheet that's called Attributes of High Quality Work. It's not a rubric for a particular assignment, but it's the attributes that we feel high quality work should have these three main attributes. It should have complexity, it should have craftsmanship, and it should have authenticity. And we read through that list before we look at each other's work, because that's what we're aiming for. Can we get these things there? Let me pause for a second. Does that raise any questions for anybody? Or anyone want to push on any of that? So if you look at that long list of what complexity is it would be great if the work had an authentic voice and was well done, but if the work itself is not stretching kids' brains, then it's not enough. Right? So this work should be challenging. It should force them to think in different ways. It should force them to take on multiple perspectives. It should force them to understand big concepts in the discipline. So complexity isn't one feature. You'll see about eight bullets under there. But it's, we want to think, are we giving kids work that's challenging enough? Or are we underestimating what they can do? And in almost every school I visit, and I visit schools all the time, people underestimate. They're not pushing kids enough, I think. I think we can always be pushing kids more than we do. So I want to do a little exercise with you now. I'm going to have you look at two pieces of student work and think about, do I think these have quality to them? Do I prefer one to the other? How would I name the quality in them? So there is a green and a yellow essay, each written by a 10th grade girl. The prompt is the same. It's a This I Believe essay. Okay? So I would like you each now to read Emma's and Joanna's This I Believe essay. You can mark them up, text code them in any way. And then at your table, you're going to choose a partner, and you're going to say, all right, which do you think was better and why? Defend yourself and see if you agree with your partner. And can you give evidence about what you think good writing is? Okay, you can begin. Okay, as soon as you're done, find another person, not by sitting down, but by standing up and meeting somebody new in the room. And when you meet that new person, shake their hand, introduce yourself, and say, all right, which one did you like better? Did you have a preference? Did you think one was better? Do you think these are quality? What do you think about quality? What makes one quality? I'm interested. So meet somebody new and discuss, would you agree, bless you, on whether there's quality here in either one of these or in both of these or if you have a preference. So as soon as you're done, stand up and you see someone else standing up, meet them and have a conversation. If you had to choose one or the other, how many of you would choose, raise your hand, how many of you would choose Emma's, the yellow one, as your, okay? And then how many of you would choose Joanna's? Interesting, a little more to Emma in this group. Obviously, this is like a fake battle of the essays, right? I mean, I chose two essays, both of which I thought had real power. But I'm intrigued often by having how people would describe it. What I wanted to model for you here was, this is what I want to have happening in schools. I want to have teachers getting together and looking at math work, looking at science work, looking at writing work, and talking about what makes it good or not good. Like, we don't do that in our schools. We just don't. And this is the push. How are we going to get kids to be better if we're not talking about it all the time? So let me just give you an example. I took these same two essays, and I did it with a faculty, and I had them talk about what did they value in Joanna's or Emma's pieces, and we had a really gripping conversation as a faculty, and then the next day, I went into all the classes in the high school, and I did the same thing, and we had that conversation, and then I said, you know, I did this with your teachers yesterday, and they said, no way, and I said, why? They said, our teachers wouldn't do that. And I said, what do you mean they wouldn't do that? They said, they're not all English teachers. I said, oh, really? You don't think the math and science teachers and the physical education, they said, well, how do they know what, I don't know, they don't think about what good writing is. I said, oh, really? And I said, do you have a sense of which one they preferred? And they said, oh, they all preferred Emma's. And I said, why? And they said, well, it's got more complex vocabulary in it. So, I mean, that's what teachers look for, right? They look for complex vocabulary in your work. Like, that's. And I said, do you want to know what they actually said about the work? And they said, okay. I said, most teachers spoke about the feeling and the honesty, like the courage of talking about stuff that's true to you and the vulnerability that Emma and Joanna both had a little bit and sharing things that were hard to share. And the kids were like, that's what they talked about? And I said, yeah. They said, they just could not believe it. They said, we thought teachers only think about spelling and vocabulary and because they've never said to us that they care about our true voice or honesty or courage. Like, no one ever said that to us. Like, how come that's what they care about if they've never told us that? Like, what makes the writing powerful to them is our honesty and our heart. Like, they never said that when we did a writing piece. Like, that's just crazy. And I thought, okay, next time I do this, which I did in the next school, I have to mix teachers and students and do this and have students and teachers looking at work. And I do this same thing, not just with essays, but with lab reports and with math solutions. And we just look at what makes a good geometry proof. Like, looking at work together is really different than abstractly thinking about it. So I hope that you can more and more get your kids and your teachers looking at work together, looking at models of work, and thinking about what do we value in writing, what do we value in science. And if you feel like, well, we don't have any models right now, I have thousands online that you can just download, including these two, in the collection, and everything is free. And then I hope you'll be sending me stuff soon for the models collection, too, that we can use. So I'm going to pivot here to, even though I've spent 43 years in project-based education, what I've been obsessed with lately is the quality of the lessons that kids are getting all day long. Not just the one project that's created by the end of the year, but how are kids actively being pushed in lessons all day long, whether they're in the middle of a project or whether they're not in a project at that moment. So I think as an ambassador, you need to be not just saying, are you doing a project this year? But what are your lessons like all day long? Are they the kind of lessons that empower and excite kids and push them? So the last book that I worked on was called Learning That Lasts, and it's around a structure we call deeper instruction. I put the framework, it's in pink, it's in your folder. I can't give you the book for free, but I can give you the framework for free. And it's a framework we use around, are the lessons we're using strong lessons? So we feel like it's not just the project that a kid gets to do once a semester or twice a year or whatever, but it's also the quality of instruction that's going on all day long. And so I went through a big learning curve for me of, I used to obsess only about beautiful student work, and now I've been obsessing about beautiful lessons. So I've had this gift since I've been out of the classroom of being able to travel around the country to places like High Tech High and sit in on lessons and find beautiful lessons. And then I find these teachers that blow me away, that were greater, way greater than I ever was as a teacher. They might be a pre-K teacher, they might be an 11th grade math teacher, and I think, I want to videotape this person. Like, I cannot believe how beautiful her lessons are. And then I have to line up my video team and get them there and hope that the lesson they see is as good as the lesson I was lucky enough to see, which, you know, that doesn't work that way. It doesn't matter how great a teacher you are. You have lessons that bomb and lessons that don't, or kids that are off one day or they aren't, or you have a lockdown in the middle of your day, not that that could ever happen. You know, like those kinds of things just happen. So sometimes I'm lucky, sometimes I'm not. Like, I've had our filmmaker call me up and say, I know that you sent me there. I spent 3 days there. I'm not going to cut anything. And I'd say, okay, all right. I lost $7,000, but okay. Like, because we've refused to produce lessons that aren't great. But I can tell you we have 280 of them online that you're welcome, and I'm going to look at a couple with you today. Both are high school lessons. I chose a history lesson and a science lesson. So if that's not your subjects, I'm sorry. Let me tell you about the setting for both of these, and Randy pointed out to me that if I stand over here, it actually works. So I have 150 schools that I am lucky enough to work with in our network. They are a mixture of district public schools and charter public schools. So a lot of both. But I chose a district public school in the middle of Queens because I just wanted to be a counterpoint to, if you're sitting here, like, there's no place in the world like High Tech High. It's a little intimidating to be here because for me, when I come here, it's like the world's most beautiful building, the climate, the culture. Like, this is such a beautiful place in so many ways that you might feel like, yeah, but when I go back, it's just not like that where I am. So I wanted to pick a place that isn't like this and has the high pressure of New York City district clamping down on them around test scores, so that we can say, okay, this is not something that you need High Tech High in order to do. We can get inspired here and go back to our own setting and do it. So the schools is Metropolitan Expeditionary Learning School. It's the yellow one. The reason there's multiple signs is this is a big building with multiple schools in the same big building. So it's in Queens, New York, and it is a project-based school in a high-pressure, high-stakes, test-oriented district. So it's a 6 through 12 public district school, and their results have been great. Super proud of them. 98% of kids are graduating on time and going to college, every single kid since the school opened. So I don't know about your district, but for New York City, this is like phenomenally good. And even beyond that, 90% of their graduates are still in college. So, you know, for their demographic, it would be 11% graduating from college. So something's going right in this school. And so I want to show you two videos for that school so you can see what are you noticing in these videos. And what I hope you're seeing is the power of a different kind of lesson that's really pushing kids in a different way. So I'm going to start with the science lesson. We'll watch it's a five-minute video of a full period science lesson. And then at your table, I'm interested in what do you notice and wonder about that lesson. This is one of the ones that I'm obsessed with. Like, this is one of the teachers I found. I thought, I have to videotape her.
Folks who were here yesterday know that we're working towards the culmination of this case study, and you guys asked for some information yesterday.
Hillary Mills' 11th grade biology students are at a powerful junction in the learning process.
We're at the point where we are wrapping up our case study, an investigation into the use of this TALEN gene therapy, which is a particular gene editing technique that's being used to combat Duchenne's disease.
At a moment when many teachers might decide to conclude the learning with a summative assessment, Hillary's class decides to push themselves more deeply into the content.
They've invested a significant amount of time in terms of learning a variety of science content. They're swimming in all of the science that they know, and they're trying to figure out a way to piece it together. So what we're going to do at this point is we are going to be able to have a bioethical debate or an academic conversation that talks about the use of TALEN gene therapy as a means to combat Duchenne's.
We captured the class for 2 days, expecting to see how students prepare for and hold an academic conversation on the complex topic of TALEN gene therapy. On the second day, however, Hillary decides to postpone the conversation, choosing instead to support her students in deepening their understanding of the topic. In this two-part video, we look first at how the class uses a complex scientific figure to activate and push thinking. In the second video, we explore how students make connections among concepts and technical vocabulary and use scientific notebooks to organize their thinking for the upcoming conversation.
So I found this really awesome science journal article that was produced by a group of scientists who have actually done some of these clinical studies using TALEN gene therapy. And they produced a figure that I think is going to be interesting to us. To match sort of where their level of science is, I went to the figures and the data tables and found this particular figure that was a demonstration of what happens when this gene therapy is used.
By selecting a highly technical figure, one that referenced and activated familiar content and vocabulary, but remained puzzling in explicit meaning, Hillary set her students up to grapple with their conceptual understanding of TALEN gene therapy.
My students access documents across the board, in math classes, global history, English. When analyzing documents, it's almost never about what is right or wrong, but how they're making sense of what they're looking at.
So we go into the document and we'll look for everything we know and we'll try to piece it together. And I think we're so good at that because we've done it so often.
So a document that could be slightly intimidating, really overwhelming, something that they've never seen before, any student can enter that with basic observations that they see and inferences that they could make based on the observations that they're making. We have 4 minutes. Get your questions answered. Build on each other's ideas. We're trying to figure out how this TALEN gene therapy works. So when scientists look at any type of document, they don't do this in isolation. So there's an element of needing to talk through or collaborate with other scientists, which is exactly what we try and mimic in our science classroom.
So what I was wondering was that, are they shifting it out of frame until the stop is no longer there?
So basically after they go back into the amino acids, they basically readjust the reading frame.
I'll start with that. I have a question. When it was like down at the bottom underneath section B, when it was transcribing the original DNA, I was wondering if this is literally what it looks like when they're doing TALEN gene therapy. Like, you see where it's like an N and then it's like parentheses and there's an X underneath it.
1 minute
left. Does
that
mean you're taking out that base pair?
And so when we invest a lot of time looking at a common document that we all have access to, one of the essential parts is giving students space to talk about it and to come to some type of collaborative understanding based on every person who's entering that conversation. I heard some sweet conversations. A couple things I just wanted to celebrate. I saw Someone go back to their notes on transcription. I saw someone else bust out their mRNA amino acid chart. Did you figure anything out?
The first line of translated DNA could have been Duchenne's disease, and the second line could have been Becker's.
There's a big emphasis in talking like scientists in our classroom. This is something that is developed over a long period of time and is something that is continually honored and practiced. Tara, you had a quick thought before we build on this.
We think the N stands for like the stop that the TALEN gene therapy is inserting into the genetic code.
Because there is an expectation that when you share out, whether it's with your small table or the whole class, that you're speaking in full sentences. Those full sentences help to use the vocabulary and contextualize whatever students are saying.
So when we're talking about frame shifting, we're talking about a totally different reading of the mRNA during translation.
And how does that happen? Catherine, can you add on a little bit? Thanks, Kritika.
You add in a base pair.
I think we're great at talking about science because our teacher does a great job at emphasizing it.
And what do we mean by reading? I'm just pushing us a little bit because it's going to help set us up.
When it codes for a specific amino acid, and when you go, she asks us to be more specific if we're not using the knowledge we've gotten well enough, or she'll tell us to respond in full sentences so we really get our entire thought out there.
I think that the expectation has to be there that kids can be scientists. And more than anything, in order for that to happen, is there has to be space for their voice. There has to be space for them to make understanding out of whatever it is that they are having access to. As a scientist, they have the responsibility to make sense of the world around them. You need to come prepared tomorrow. You guys know that academic conversations and scientific debates are only fun when people are prepared, right? Resources are here. Text coding you know how to do. You did a lot of good practicing of it today. Use any resources from today. Any questions, send them my way.
Okay, the next day in that class is also a video. If you're interested, you can watch that from Get It Online. I'm interested in, at your table right now, what did you notice, what did you wonder in looking at, in thinking about either her planning or how that lesson went? So, at your tables, 4 minutes. Okay, I'm gonna call us back. Why am I taking time to show lessons in a project-based learning workshop? Because even if you're a project-based school, we have to have great lessons. Like, this sets the tone for kids' independence and collaboration. This is how they learn to work together, speak clearly. Like, we have to structure these things. It's not natural for kids to just do great projects together and collaborate and think deeply. We have to model that in these kinds of lessons so that when the project starts, kids know what to do. They have already been pushed in this way. They know how to work in this way. I'll just share a few highlights I heard from walking around. One of the first things I heard about this lesson was the material was like freaking graduate level material. Like, these are regular public school kids in a low income community in 11th grade science being given at least college, but probably graduate level work to do, which we often don't do. We dumb the work down and not assume they could do this stuff, and these kids are being pushed. Another thing was people noticed her lesson structure of starting with a document that no single kid in the room understood, but every kid had an entry point to. And she didn't have a differentiated easy version for anyone. Everyone had to start with this document, but every kid had some starting place, and so they could work together to sort of make sense of it. So every kid was challenged. And she didn't try to entertain them first. She tried to make the challenge the engagement. Like, we don't know what this is. We got to figure this out. And we use that same strategy and lesson structure for history classes and math classes and for all that work. And then she did very little of the talking. She was like, oh, how'd you figure that out? Oh, tell me more. Where's your evidence? Like, she just pushed them to do all the work. And so we often talk about students doing all the thinking, but what does that actually look like? So I'm going to show you one more video. It's a 10th grade history class. This one I particularly wanted to show you because this school is under tremendous pressure, as I would guess you are, around test scores. And in New York State, one of the big pressures they have are what they call DBQs, document-based questions, right? You have to read the document and then give a document-based question answer that shows evidence from the document that you cited. So how this school, which kicks butt on test scores, how do they do that in a way that's not just telling kids what to do? This is a lesson that's entirely set around how do we get kids ready for the high-stakes document-based questions that are going to determine their future on the Regents tests in New York.
In an era of high-stakes testing, when many teachers feel pressure to choose breadth over depth, Claire Wolf's 10th grade humanities class is preparing for the New York Regents exam by thinking critically about primary sources. She's decided to turn the tables on her students, asking them to take on the roles of history teachers to curate a collection of primary source documents that are the best match for a document-based question, or DBQ, the kind of question they will soon face on the Regents.
Instead of just going through the motions and following a task that someone else laid out for them, now they're really thinking critically about why certain documents might be more relevant and evaluating the documents that they would give to a high school history classroom.
Good morning, good morning.
So I wanted to start class by just kind of getting on the same page about what a historian does.
People say, what are some ideas we have, Jonathan?
Historian studies a specific time period or event and becomes an expert on it.
Okay, so studies?
We do a lot of work in my class where we think about where our learning comes from.
I said historians think deeply about the sources they have and go beyond what is plainly shown.
How historians found out this information that we're using in our classroom.
Historians try to understand the history of past human society in order to better understand our current society and how it functions.
Throughout the semester, Claire's students have been studying the Holocaust through the lens of four themes: political and economic conditions, the impact of fascist ideology, human rights violations, and choices made by individuals or communities. Today, students are working with over 20 primary sources with which they are deeply familiar, matching those sources to each of the themes.
Their task was to come to consensus in groups about which 8 documents they thought best told the story of the Holocaust. In their table groups, I asked the students to first talk about and then really be explicit in their thinking about why they selected those documents for each part of the task.
So you're saying that their response was to accept propaganda?
Like, not that they didn't have a choice, but because like the white girls, they had a choice. Like, they chose to be an activist for.
We've written a lot of DBQs, so we already understand the perspective of writing a DBQ essay.
This would be good for explaining the impact of fascist ideology on the German people.
Yeah. Now we're actually thinking like a person who designs a DBQ essay, and it takes a lot more thinking. It makes you think like, is this document useful? Are you giving the student the resources he or she needs?
I think we should include Mein Kampf because like a lot of the, like without propaganda, this wouldn't have happened if he wasn't like talking about them.
So that they could make that thinking visible to other kids in the classroom, I had them write on Post-its. So one thing they had to think about was, how does this document relate to the task? What's the history here?
Remember to write clearly enough so that your classmates can come around and examine them and see your thinking.
The second one then is, thinking like a history teacher, why did your table group prioritize this document? What made it more relevant or significant than these other documents that you decided not to use?
After finalizing their selections, the class began a gallery walk.
As we walk around, we are thinking about this question. How do history teachers select documents for students? Were they thinking about the content of the document?
So there are a lot of times that it makes sense to be pulling in primary source documents. I use them a lot at the very beginning of a case study to build student interest and create a mystery. But before using documents to have complex conversations about bias and perspective, I think it's important to lay a groundwork with a shared narrative. Because if students don't have an understanding of the narrative history, they're not going to be able to access those documents.
Most 10th grade classrooms are focused on writing a DBQ essay. You guys took it a step further and you created your own DBQ essay. And then you took it a step even further and you thought about the thinking of the creation. What are some of the things that you guys kept in mind
when you chose these documents. And we're adding to note catcher, so please keep it out.
If you can answer the question based on only the document.
Does it connect to other documents in a way that would help develop the task?
Specifically for images, I feel like we should look at how much they say, because we had the entrance to Auschwitz. If you don't have background knowledge on that, you would never guess what it is, right? That was one of the documents I picked for the DBQ, and I had to like pair it up with another picture because it's like not something you can pull from.
Fantastic. So does it give the student enough information?
We ended class with a synthesis ticket that allowed students to sort of place themselves on a spectrum.
We have here our work of a historian, and we have here our work of a history teacher. You have notes on both. What do you think?
And where they were on the spectrum, I wasn't as concerned with. I was more interested in what connections did they see and what disparities did they see between our shared vision of what historians do and what we're doing as history teachers in this project task.
I feel like it's the job of a historian to come to the conclusions by analyzing the documents, and then it's the job of the history teacher to take these ideas that have already been formed and pass them on to students, that gets them to think about the why and gets them to think about.
It is hard to cover all of the things that our students might be tested on in these very high stakes exams.
Your audience is students, right? And students have different needs that a historian doesn't really have to worry about. So
but what I found is that act of being the historian by looking at the documents and evaluating them and then having an opinion about history.
So I feel you have a more important and a more complex role because your goal is to make us understand.
Is what makes it stay with them. So much more than spending more time on something or covering more topics.
So my time with you is at an end. I want to say this is what I'm hoping for when I go into schools, is not this break between now they're doing projects and now they're doing standard lessons where kids are just sitting passively. It's the lessons like this for me that I feel like build those skills that allow kids to be good PBL learners. So you saw the level of metacognition, the reflection, the patterns that these kids have developed in the school of we work in small teams, we listen to each other. Like, I did listen into a lot of groups who said, this didn't start in that class. Like, this is the school working together to build those skills in kids across classes. So my hope is that all of us can think, it's not just what about the project itself, it's what about the ways in we deal with the kids every day in every lesson that makes them, that sort of raises the stakes for the way they collaborate, the way they speak, the way they think metacognitively about their work. I'm gonna end with my shameless request to you, which is when you go on Models of Excellence, which I know you will, and you look at that great collection of hundreds and hundreds of projects that you might wanna borrow ideas from and student writing that you might wanna borrow from all different disciplines, that you think, oh, I've got to send some student work from my school to that site. I can't guarantee that the induction team, the curation team at Harvard will select yours, but they'll never select it if you don't send it, right? So please do send us some more work, because this is just an open resource for teachers, by teachers, to spread models of great work. And I also hope that you're looking for good lessons like this in your building so that more teachers can watch each other. That's why I'm filming these right now. Like, it was all beautiful student work for me, and now that these beautiful lessons are making me so excited too. So both things are great to obsess about. I'll be with you for 2 days. Thanks for your time and listening.